Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents In Search of Meadowlarks, Birds, Farms, and Food in Harmony with the Land by John M. Marzluff. Narrated by Danny Campbell. Preface. As the world struggles with sustaining intensive industrial-scale agriculture, a wave of mostly young new farmers is hitting the land. Rather than intensifying production to limit the spread of agriculture, they work the land less thoroughly and in concert with supporting natural processes. This new agriculture seeks to provide safe food in a way that also sustains rural lives and the natural biological diversity that shares our planet. New farmers are confident they can feed the world's increasing population by supplying nearby residents a diverse harvest of plants and low-impact meats that wastes less and naturally maintains soil fertility. The methods the new farmers use go by several names. Some call their approach ecological agriculture, or agroecology. To others, it is known as sustainable, restoration, or conservation agriculture. Whatever the name, the practices are in stark contrast to large-scale conventional agriculture, where pesticides and herbicides made in distant factories are used to grow vast monocultures of corn, wheat, rice, and other grains. Some new farmers employ only organic practices, whereas others seek to sustain their businesses and lands with more traditional methods. The meat and dairy products produced on an ecological farm come not from vast herds crammed into feedlots, where they are sustained by unnatural foods and excessive regimens of pharmaceuticals, but rather from respectfully tended herds. Many ecological farmers step back in time to grow different food plants and animals together and foster a diversity of heritage breeds and crops well-suited to their local environment. Such polycultures are more secure than intensive monocultures because their diversity lowers the risk of crop loss to disease, freak weather, and pests. Perennial crops such as nuts, berries, fungi, and honey are often important diversifying threads in an ecological polyculture, which may be referred to as a permaculture. Ecological farmers work to maintain soil health by eliminating or reducing tilling and composting manure and inedible portions of crops. Returning compost to the soil conserves water and closes the loop connecting a farm's use of soil nutrients with its production of foodstuffs. Restoring what is taken from the local ecosystem sustains continued production without the need for outside supplements. This self-reliance frees the ecological farmer from the demands of big chemical, seed, or stock companies. My hope for the future is stoked by the new ecological farming movement that is sweeping the land, and by new technologies that allow industrial farms to produce more food with less waste and pollution. In both approaches, the nexus between food production and conservation of Earth's biological riches interests and drives me to write this book. In the following sections, I recount some of the details that are emerging as to how we might shift diets, improve farm productivity, and more equitably and justly share the bounty. But I do so primarily as they relate to conservation of land for the wild animals that roam in and around our farms. My frame of reference for this consideration comes from the library and the field. There is burgeoning scientific literature that assesses the costs and benefits of coupling intensive agriculture with natural area reservation, so-called land sparing, and contrasts these with a less intensive, wildlife-friendly approach that incorporates elements of nature into farming, so-called land sharing. I am eager to learn how these approaches work on lands I regularly visit. The scientific frameworks of land sharing and land sparing guide my search for agriculture that is in harmony with the land. In my quest, I travel from a family-run corn and soybean farm in southeast Nebraska, where the birds that once enlivened farm life with their beautiful song have declined, to farms and ranches in Montana, California, Washington, and Costa Rica that welcome wildlife. As production intensifies on traditional farms, I'm pleased to find some native animals, but I see little evidence that increased harvest enables other lands to be spared. On farms that share land with wildlife, I find that agriculture can coexist with a wealth of native birds, as well as bears, wolves, monkeys, and sloths. Marketing a diversity of crops and diversifying farm income through tourism, recreation, and environmental education sustains the vibrant lands worked by the ecologically minded farmer. My search convinces me that farmers of the future need not resign themselves to a life disconnected from the wild voices that sing from their fields. Living in harmony with the land will demand much from us all, farmer and consumer. As we visit farms and ranches that produce grains, meat, fruits, and vegetables, I link our dietary choices to the fate of native wildlife. As we come to know some of the farmers and ranchers I've visited, we quickly appreciate their revolutionary approach to working the land. We will meet fantastic pioneers who value bears, trout, warblers, and trogons every bit as much as they appreciate beef, veggies, and cocoa. Many of these innovators are young, not surprising, given that agriculture is an increasingly popular college degree. My journey has also been personal. My wife's grandfather was a first-generation Nebraska grain farmer who started raising diverse crops and livestock, mostly with horse and human labor. His farm survives to this day because he embraced the selective breeding, mechanical and chemical revolutions that enabled corn and soybeans to dominate the farmland of the American Middle West. My daughter and nephew typify the more massive revolution I sensed. Both graduated from college with an interest in farming, but honed their skills with a series of internships and on-the-job training. Despite their experience, they shunned the revolution in work efficiency that my grandfather-in-law embraced. They worked the land much as he did at the start of his career, relying on their muscles and innovations to raise a diversity of crops and animals. Watching the next generation of my family return to the farm intrigued me to learn even more and share what I found. As I have searched for farms and ranches working in harmony with the land, I have discovered what each of us can do to meet the grand challenge of growing food sustainably. This is not an easy lift, because we will be required to incentivize governments and private citizens to shrink or soften existing agricultural lands, to develop technologies that increase crop performance on distant continents where climates are harsh and fickle, to shift our diets away from overconsumption of ruminant, primarily cow, goat, and sheep meat and dairy products, and to reduce food waste. Adjusting our actions to meet the challenge is the right thing to do because, as the environmental scientist and philosopher Aldo Leopold said, it increases the stability, integrity, and beauty of our planet. Failing the challenge dooms future generations to a lonely life made more difficult without the services provided by intact ecosystems and less pleasurable from the loss of daily encounters with wild nature. 1. Meadowlarks in decline. The rolling hills of rich black dirt are striped with neat rows of twin green leaves that have just shouldered their way through the soil toward the sun. As I look through the early morning mist that hovers over the Illinois field, I strain to hear the sweet whistle of a meadowlark's song. Finally, the prairie wind carries the familiar tune from my childhood toward me. I spot the plump, yellow-breasted singer with his contrasting black V-neck plumage atop an old fence post about a football field's distance away. As he throws back his head, the beautiful music pours forth. This bird and its melody are iconic of the American grasslands. Streets, businesses, schools, and celebrities appropriate its name. 6 of the United States claim this avian as their state bird. In state pageantry, only the cardinal is more popular. Today, however, meadowlark populations are greatly reduced. A century ago, they were the most common bird in Illinois grasslands, but today, ubiquitous red-winged blackbirds and European starlings dominate the meadowlark's former stronghold, And no wonder. More than half of the meadowlark's once rich prairie home has been simplified into a monoculture. Today, as I listen to the lark, the dominant grass for miles is zea maize, known as maize or corn. I am creeping along a yellow dirt road through an early spring drizzle a couple of hours west of Chicago to see for myself how the changing prairie has affected birds such as the meadowlark. Other ornithologists have reconnoitered my exact path every spring since 1966. Starting on the small wooden bridge that crosses Mill Creek, passing prominent gray farmhouses, woodlots, fence lines, and telephone poles, before ending 25 miles later just beyond Shannon Road. This is Illinois Route 2 of the North American Breeding Bird Survey. It is one of nearly 3,700 such roadside rambles annually assessed by volunteers across the United States and Canada. Their efforts enable scientists to measure changes in populations of all the birds that breed in the area. The trend in meadowlark sightings on Illinois Route 2 is not good. In 2014, only 16 of the birds, 9 eastern meadowlarks and 7 western meadowlarks, were counted. This pales in comparison to the heady counts of nearly 100 western and more than 30 eastern meadowlarks during the late 1960s and early 1970s. It takes me an hour and a half before I hear my first meadowlark, an eastern, belting forth a high-pitched, if simple, tingling from an abandoned grassy field. A mile farther down the road, I encounter the second meadowlark in a pasture rimmed by corn and grassy swales. After 3 hours, I'm at the end of the route, and my tally stands at 6 larks, 3 each of the eastern and western species. This is the lowest meadowlark count ever recorded on Illinois Route 2. The loss of meadowlarks is symbolic of the plight of birds that once regularly greeted farming families across the globe. Worldwide, 5,407 species, 62% of rare species classified as threatened on the International Union for Conservation of Nature's Red List, are challenged by expanding and intensifying agricultural practices. Only overhunting and overfishing of rare animals threaten a more significant number. Together, these and other human assaults on Earth more than halved the population sizes of mammals, birds, fish, amphibians, and other vertebrates between 1970 and 2012. Grassland birds have been especially hard hit. According to John Faubourg, an Iowa-born professor of ecology at the University of Missouri, grassland birds have shown the most consistent declines since the inception of the Breeding Bird Survey. Ornithologist Fritz Knopf agrees, noting that grassland birds have shown steeper, more consistent, and more geographically widespread declines than any other group of North American birds. The eastern meadowlark is a case in point. It has declined not only on Illinois Route 2, but also throughout its entire North American breeding range. The estimated population has decreased by 71% since 1966. The reason for the decline in farmland birds is fundamentally the loss of grass, but the drivers of this loss extend beyond rampant conversion of prairies and other grasslands into chemically amended row crops. We have plowed up turf and significantly hampered the ability of grasslands to regenerate and rehabilitate themselves because we extinguished the forces that create and maintain them, fire, bison, and prairie dogs. Grasslands once covered a quarter of the Earth's land. By the end of the 20th century, humans had removed over a fifth of the world's native grassland, converting most of it to cropland. In North America, it has been even worse. More than half of this continent's 1 billion acres of grass is gone. Most of this loss occurred west of the Mississippi River, beginning in 1850, as homesteaders discovered the fertile soils of Iowa, Kansas, and Nebraska. The rate of the prairie plow-up from 1850 to 1990 averaged 2.6 million acres each year, which alone could not contain the simultaneous 3.1 million acres annual increase in cropland. The pace of change has not yet abated. 7.3 million acres of prairie, pasture, and hayfields were converted to cropland in the United States from 2008 to 2012. 55 million acres of grass were lost from the Great Plains of the United States and Canada from 2009 through 2015. That loss represents 13% of the total that remained and equals an area the size of Kansas. The latest surge in cropland is a result of growing personal affluence. Because corn and soybeans are fed to beef cattle crowded into industrial feedlots, or distilled into biofuels that in part power our insatiable vehicles. People eat less than 3% of the corn raised in the United States. The inability of the meadowlark to live peacefully among the corn mirrors humanity's increasing struggle to live in harmony with the land. Before the mechanization that followed World War II, and the ultra-productive miracle crop varieties and fertilizers that boosted yields of cereal grains in the 1960s, most farmers in Middle America and elsewhere worked small holdings of diverse crops and livestock. Meadowlarks found refuge in the pastures and fallow grounds that were interspersed among fields of vegetables, grains, and legumes. This refuge was short-lived, as technical advancements, economic policies, and shifting cultural norms conspired to favor fewer, bigger, and more intensely managed farms. Expansive monocultures of wheat, corn, soybeans, rice, rye, barley, or oats became the norm. Pesticides, herbicides, and fertilizers were employed to sustain productivity. Natural field edges, woodlands, and seasonal wetlands were plowed, cut, diked, and drained to increase arable land. Pastures were mowed earlier and more often, or forced to support larger herds of livestock as corporate owners who did not live on the property sought to wring every last bit of energy from the soil. The degree of such intensification correlates strongly with the declines in farmland wildlife across North America and Europe. Modern farmers in North America are now rarely in the company of prairie chickens, bobolinks, and eastern meadowlarks, whereas their compatriots in Europe would be lucky to hear the call of a stone curlew or see the flash of a red-backed shrike on the hunt for grasshoppers and mice in their fields. The loss of birds and other natural features from farms is, in some sense, an inevitable consequence of our need to eat. In response to increased demand, farmers doubled the production of wheat, corn, and a few other grains in the 1960s and 1970s. Food production during this green revolution increased annually by 32 million metric tons. And because of new crop varieties that could withstand drought and grow in poor soil, and greater use of fertilizers, irrigation, and pesticides, these gains came with relatively small 9% increases in the amount of new land that was brought into cultivation. Norman Borlaug, the father of the Green Revolution, claimed that this intensification spared hundreds of millions of acres from the plow. A 2013 study suggests some more modest but impressive savings of between 45 million and 90 million acres. The Green Revolution has been slow to reach parts of the developing world, where land continues to be cleared to feed the population. In tropical regions, for example, 12 million to 45 million acres of forest are removed annually for crops. 27% of tropical forests worldwide have already been converted to agricultural fields. The careful breeding of new crop varieties during the Green Revolution can reduce the amount of land required to feed people. But doing so has required massive inputs of nitrogen and phosphorus fertilizers as well as irrigation. The runoff of fertilizers and drawdown of aquifers from these activities degrades freshwater, marine, and terrestrial ecosystems and propels an agricultural system that emits about a third of all greenhouse gases that result from human activity. The methane and nitrous oxide produced by cattle and other ruminant livestock drive climate change more than does our burning of fossil fuels for transportation. One might justify this ecological damage if the human population were adequately nourished, but despite a global glut of food, by some estimates, 23% more than we currently need, one in every 10 people is undernourished. Unequal access to the riches of the harvest relates to social and cultural factors such as affordability, governance, and gender. Ecologists conclude that cultivating crops and keeping livestock have had greater impacts on the rest of the planet than any other human activity. And this impact is expected to rise sharply in the coming decades. Global human populations are predicted to top 9 billion by 2050 and 11 billion by 2100. Diets are likely to include more significant quantities of meat as personal affluence increases, especially in China and the global south. These projections put us in a bit of a pickle. Although few doubt the possibility of feeding 11 billion people, some believe it will come at a steep cost to our planet. Estimates suggest that nourishing the masses is possible, but would require a 10% to 20% increase in cropland and a 70% increase in crop production. That equates to farming an additional 575,000 to 1.2 million square miles, yet only 1.5 million square miles of productive land remain on Earth, which must also accommodate the expanding footprint of our cities, as well as the ground required to produce bioenergy, wood products, and the like. Some experts gauge that our needs exceed Earth's capacity by some 2.3 million square miles, an area nearly as large as Australia. It is easy to become pessimistic about the future when confronting such statistics, but let's not lose hope so fast. A wide range of farmers, academics, and politicians are engaged in solving how best to feed a growing human population without destroying the world. Some consider where existing croplands are underperforming and seek to close such yield gaps with new crop varieties, precise allocation of water and fertilizer, increased sharing of knowledge, and enhanced infrastructure to support the farming industry. They propose that such intensification can be done without further environmental damage because it reduces water use, polluted runoff, and demand for clearing natural areas. In addition to this sustainable intensification, others propose that we must also reformulate the human diet, reduce food waste, or govern agricultural land as a global common to justly nourish humanity. Reducing our future consumption of meat and dairy products from grain-fed cattle, goats, and sheep would allow more existing arable land to grow crops fit for human ingestion. At present, a third of arable land grows food for our livestock, some 3.8 billion of which shared the planet with us in 2016. Culling the herd and eating more plants, poultry, pigs, and non-trawled seafood not only reduce the demand for farmland, but also reduce greenhouse gas emissions and improve human health. The challenge of growing agriculture sustainably while shrinking its footprint dramatically can be met if the world adopts the changes I have just outlined. In fact, research suggests that closing yield gaps, halting farmland expansion, increasing cropping efficiency, shifting diets, and reducing waste can double or triple food production while reducing greenhouse gas emissions, pollution from fertilizers and pesticides, water use, and extinction of native plants and animals. Alternatively, continuing to decelerate human population growth is seen by many as the only way in which our future needs can be fulfilled without extinguishing substantial portions of Earth's biodiversity. As we farm smarter and eat healthier, I wonder what the world will look like in a few centuries. Will we spare remaining wildlands for the rare and shy species that depend on reserves? If we do, will our farms become increasingly hostile to native plants and animals, or will we also learn how to better share agricultural lands with wildlife? As we consider sharing the land, I find it useful to reflect on familiar animals, especially ones whose declines are hard to perceive, such as the meadowlark. Despite our being able to glimpse this bird across much of North America, its abundance is in freefall. As I listen to farmers and the birds their lands harbor, I hear the benefits of an agrarian life shared with others. On the prairies and dry grasslands of Illinois, it comes in the form of the meadowlark's song in the still morning air. 2. Heritage. Farming, which I consider broadly to mean the domestication and cultivation of wild plants and animals for food, work, or pleasure, did not come quickly to our early ancestors. The lineage of increasingly upright, innovative, and cultured apes from which we evolved remained on the continent of Africa for most of its 5 to 7 million-year-long history. It wasn't until 45,000 to 60,000 years ago that these brainy walkers, who were less closely tied to the forest than their brethren, the chimpanzees, began to spread across the world. Although we belong to the only species alive today, fossil remains indicate that our line was previously much more diverse. Some anthropologists recognize as many as 23 species, which they call homonyms, our immediate ancestors. Most homonyms form a grade of increasing stature and brain size through time. A few of the most recent forms were contemporaries and even interbred. Though we Homo sapiens are the only survivors, we are at home on every scrap of Earth's land except Antarctica. We traveled to the moon and are the only ape to cultivate our own food. A chimp heritage is easy to see within our DNA. A recent comparison of the human genome, the full complement of our DNA, with that of our closest living relatives, the chimpanzee, pan troglodytes, and the bonobo, pan paniscus, reveals that humans share genes with both. The actual sequences of the nucleic acids that comprise DNA are 96% similar between humans and chimps. However, when it comes to differences in the amino acids that these sequences encode, humans and chimps are more than 99% similar. This latter statistic is important because amino acids combine to form the proteins that affect our development and contribute to our looks and actions. To understand our agrarian nature, however, we must look beyond our DNA into our culture. Culture can evolve when members of a group copy the novel actions of others and spread the innovation within and across generations. As individuals learn new behaviors, words, beliefs, and rituals from their group members, some such traditions gain in popularity and help to define a group's culture. This rapid and powerful transformative process has bestowed on all three living members of the chimpanzee family many distinctive characters. Our use of particular tools, languages, and styles of dress evolved through this method. The longevity, social lifestyle, and profound brain of our lineage gave us the ability to innovate and rapidly communicate knowledge that shapes our practices and beliefs in ways that DNA alone cannot. This culture acts as a ratchet to push its own complexity and also to affect the evolution of our genes. In so doing, we adapt to our environment and our society, evolving culturally and genetically to meet the challenges of our homeland and its inhabitants. The evolution of farming is a potent example. Farming is one of three or four hallmarks of the human species, along with language, art, and technology, especially that which led to effective use of fire. This grand accomplishment distinguished us from other apes. Distinction in the cultivated field did not come quickly. Although modern humans peopled a considerable portion of Earth for the last 200,000 years, agriculture was developed only as the world began to thaw at the end of the last ice age. Generations of people isolated in the Near East, Far East, and North America are thought to have tinkered with the seeds, roots, and wild animals they gathered during the last few interglacial periods when the climate was warm and moist, and attempts to sow, reap, and herd might have succeeded. However, failures would have been regular as well, because the environment frequently turned cold and dry. The challenges of life when climate returned to cold and dry conditions 13,000 years ago, a period referred to as the Younger Dryas, may have spurred life-saving innovations to domesticate plants and animals. However, this period also is thought to have stalled the widespread adoption of a farming life until the climate was consistently warm and wet, which happened about 11,500 years ago. The ability to succeed at farming hinged in significant part on our ancestors' abilities to domesticate native plants and animals. While early people may have tried to tame many organisms, few became fully domesticated, that is, completely dependent on humans for their survival and often reproduction. For example, it is estimated that 2,500 plants in 160 taxonomic families have undergone some degree of cultivation by people, yet only 250 are considered fully domesticated. In cases involving plants and many animals, there appears to be a fairly regular progression of domestication through several phases. Humans initially work wild stock on their native range, confining, stewarding, and harvesting or tending those with favorable traits. Then, in the improvement phase, the frequency of desirable forms is increased by selection or favoritism. Later, farmers may cultivate unique varieties that are adapted to local ecological conditions or cultural preferences. Finally, stocks are deliberately bred to increase yield, uniformity, and quality. Purposeful breeding often involves hybridizing native stocks, a practice that is known to have occurred more than 11,000 years ago during the propagation of figs. The development of corn, or maize, illustrates the full process of domestication. Farmers in Mexico's central Balsas River Valley began favoring wild Balsas teosinte, a native grass that is the closest known relative of corn, with exposed grains tightly fastened to the seed head 8,700 years ago. Variety and the strength of seed attachment is controlled by a single gene, TGA1, in corn, and the trait may thus respond rapidly to preferential cultivation. But because plants that do not easily shatter their seeds also do not disperse well, they are often rare in natural populations. The challenges of identifying and favoring singular non-shattering forms of teosinte did not dissuade early corn farmers. In fact, the prowess of farmers to notice and favor such natural variety rapidly increased the frequency of non-shattering seed heads during the domestication of most grains, including corn, barley, buckwheat, and wheat. Favoritism and selection over the next 2,000 years increased the frequency of the preferred teosinte cultivar, resulting in corn plants with fewer branches, larger seed heads, and tiny but recognizable cobs. Continued selection among initial varieties of corn and the spread of this valuable crop north and south from its ancestral range in the southwestern Mexican highlands from 2,000 to 6,000 years ago resulted in plants producing larger cobs and variously colored and shaped kernels suited to new geographies and local preferences. For example, shriveled ears of pod corn were favored for ceremonial use by Native Americans, while small kerneled popcorn was selected in Peru, and dent kerneled corn was preferred by people making hominy and masa. Finally, high-yield corn hybrids that produce a single, uniform, and large ear of seeds per plant, which is dependent upon purposeful breeding by people, were developed during the Green Revolution of the mid-20th century. It would be a mistake to conclude that the dependence produced by domestication demonstrates human mastery over another species, or that the domestic species does not also benefit from the relationship. Instead, domestic plants and animals benefit from increased survival and often greatly expanded geographic ranges compared to their wild ancestors. The benefits of associating with humans may have pushed some animals actually to initiate the domestication process. The advantages of docile and tame behavior in wolves, Canis lupus, that scavenged human refuse, for example, may have been favored in some populations by natural selection. Approachability may have encouraged some people to prefer tolerant wolves actively, or because of increased access to food and shelter, Naturally tolerant wolves may have survived and reproduced exceptionally well around early human settlements. The pathway wolves followed to domestication was likely also taken by other commensal species, such as chickens and pigeons. In other cases, altered hunting strategies, such as only taking young males and allowing females to breed unhindered, may have favored docile behavior. This prey pathway is thought to have started the domestication of a variety of species, including sheep, goats, pigs, cows, reindeer, turkey, and vicuña. Some species were more deliberate objects of domestication, including horses, donkeys, camels, silk moths, rabbits, honeybees, hamsters, and guinea fowl. Regardless of why tolerance was favored, selection for it is known to produce a wide range of features that make tame animals especially appealing to humans. This suite of traits that evolve together as animals are tamed is known as the domestication syndrome. It includes features such as variegated coat color, reduction in tooth, snout, and head size, floppy ears, curly tails, playful behavior, frequent or non-seasonal estrus cycles, and reduced brain size that we recognize today as typical of domestic wolves, aka dogs, Canis lupus familiaris. Why such seemingly disparate traits share a common destiny is not fully understood, but a recent hypothesis suggests it is because of slight deficits in embryonic stem cells from one region that are known to develop into, or to control later, the development of vertebrate morphology, as well as the nervous, pigmentation, and adrenal systems. Even if domestication initially benefits the wild species that become favored crops, livestock, and working animals, over time humans assume a dominant role. Thanks to two centuries of scholarship ranging from archaeological field investigations to analyses of ancient DNA, we now have a relatively complete picture of our transition from hunter-gatherer to agrarian people and the role of domestication in that process. Looking at the similarities between the genes of hunter-gatherers and those of early farmers across much of the Old World, we now know that farming developed nearly simultaneously in several areas within the Fertile Crescent. This arc of innovation is the region of the Near East running north from Israel and Jordan, the Levant, through Lebanon and Syria into Turkey, Anatolia, and swinging east through Iraq and Iran. After leaving Africa 45,000 to 60,000 years ago, people first settled in the Fertile Crescent 35,000 to 40,000 years ago. Here, Anatolian, Levant, and Iranian people developed farming independently from one another. These farmers descended from local hunter-gatherers and, after a period of intense collecting and cultivating of wild cereals, quickly domesticated wheat, barley, and possibly rye. Goats and sheep were also trained after a transitional period of wild herd management on native pastures at this time, which anthropologists dub the Neolithic Revolution. Other domestications also likely began during the Revolution, even if they flourished slightly later, including oats, lentils, chickpeas, fava beans, figs, olives, cattle, and pigs. Word of farming and its produce quickly flowed out of the Fertile Crescent and into Europe, Asia, and Africa. Levantine farmers spread south into East Africa about 3,000 years ago. Iranian pastoralists, who grew wheat and grazed sheep, spread north to the higher steppe of the Caucasus Mountains and east to South Asia. Anatolian farmers spread west to mainland Europe 8,500 years ago. But news of their crops preceded the farming technology. For example, people ate wheat in Britain 8,000 years ago, but farmers there are not thought to have grown wheat until 2 millennia later. Farming was not solely an invention from the Fertile Crescent. Hunter-gatherers from the high steppes of Eurasia were the first humans to domesticate or accept the advances of a wild animal, the wolf. Their dogs and the many breeds they have spawned became essential to the agrarian life that followed. It seems that wherever humans lived, they cultivated the rich local flora and fauna. This appears to have occurred in China at the same time, if not slightly earlier than it did in the Fertile Crescent. The path to producing domestic rice, with its hallmark non-shattering seed heads, is mainly well known. By all accounts, it was a slow process. Over the last 500,000 years, wild rice diversified into several forms suited to the regions just south of retreating glaciers. These primitive forms pushed into India and China around 18,000 years ago and were managed by local hunters and gatherers. Selective harvest, stewardship, and choice of plants with favorable traits produced the first domestic, non-shattering forms 8,400 to 9,000 years ago in China. At this time, in a village in the Yangtze Basin known as the Husi site, mixtures of wild and domestic rice plants existed in a ditch structure, likely a precursor to more sophisticated field engineering, flood irrigation, and fire management that characterized later rice agriculture. Wild rice continued to be cultivated in India for millennia without domestication. The rise in domestic rice there did not occur until around 2,000 years ago as Chinese forms spread to India. The Chinese also domesticated peaches and pigs 7,600 to 8,000 years ago, chickens 4,000 to 4,500 years ago, and soybeans 3,000 years ago. Early Pacific Islanders domesticated native fruits and roots, including taro 9,000 years ago, mango 9,200 years ago, and coconut 5,000 years ago. In the Americas, early farmers in the East grew various forms of squash around 10,700 years ago, while in addition to corn, Mexican people domesticated pepper 8,500 years ago, potato 5,000 years ago, and cotton 5,500 years ago. Llamas and alpacas were domesticated in South America 5,000 to 6,000 years ago, roughly at the same time as Europeans domesticated the horse. The rapid spread of agricultural know-how from its many centers of innovation is a pattern consistent with cultural rather than genetic evolution. The invention of agriculture has in part defined us as a species because it has so profoundly affected our lifestyle. Rather than relying on our legs for transportation or our weak sense of smell for hunting, we improved by harnessing the power of domestic animals, chiefly horses and dogs. Instead of wandering in search of the next meal or suitable materials for clothing, we stayed home and grew our own grains and fibers. Switching to this new lifestyle was not without considerable hardship. For starters, it took the average early farmer a long time, an estimated 9 hours, to obtain the necessary food each day. This effort far exceeded the 6 hours it is expected to have taken hunter-gatherers. Abandoning a diet rich in protein for one featuring carbohydrates led to malnourishment of ancient farmers, witnessed by a loss of physical stature, increased tooth decay, and shortened lifespan relative to hunters and gatherers. Domesticating animals added protein to the agrarian diet, but it also compromised human health, as livestock and companion animals exposed people to many new diseases. As we battled these challenges, our immunity and medical practices evolved. Many children today are vaccinated for measles and pertussis, whooping cough. The forms of these ailments that infect humans were derived from viruses and bacteria that infested our domestic pigs, horses, dogs, and sheep. It is also likely that smallpox, tuberculosis, tapeworms, and malaria were contracted by our relationships with domestic animals, although in these cases, wild animals may have also played a complicating role. The substantial hardship of farm life makes one question why foragers ever settled down so thoroughly. Favorable climate and prior practice made farming possible, but it is likely that as our numbers grew, game animals became rare, and agriculture, which was beginning to show promise, became essential. As the human population grew and became sedentary, Changes in the social dynamic may have provided a final push to a widespread agricultural life. The desire to rise above one's peers or express one's domination over nature is thought to have spurred the domestication of rare foods, such as figs, that were featured in competitive feasts. Similarly, the aspirations for power by individuals and eventually nation-states may have led rulers to coerce peasants into an agricultural lifestyle. Yale professor of political science James C. Scott notes in Against the Grain that there is no reason why a forager in most environments would shift to agriculture unless forced to by population pressure or some form of coercion. So, although a rise in the human population may have provided an initial impetus for sustaining the agricultural processes those early foragers routinely practiced, coercion may have further shaped and maintained farming within regions. Social leaders, large landowners, and increasingly formal governing bodies that ruled regional groups in early states may have eventually forced a more permanent agricultural life on their minions. Such coercion benefits the ruling elite by providing cheap, often slave labor, taxable produce, and a steady flow of foodstuffs. Pressure, however, can and often did lead to rebellion, which, together with natural and self-imposed changes in climate and soil fertility, produce substantial ebbs and flows in the tenure of early agrarian states. The cultural influence on early agriculture is especially evident in the Western domestication of chickens and rabbits. In both cases, genetic changes in the animals occurred at the same time that religious decrees were dispensed. Fasting and abstinence from certain foods was common in early religions, but which foods and drinks could be consumed during these times of sacrifice has varied. The eating of fish was often permitted during fasts, but the meat of warm-blooded animals was not. However, in the year 600, Pope Gregory the Great decreed that newborn rabbits were suitable fasting fare because, like fish, they were not meat. In response, the French monks quickly domesticated European rabbits. Today, more than 200 rabbit breeds provide humanity with food, fiber, research subjects, and pets. Four centuries later, crowded urban living and a proclamation by the Benedictine monastic order enabling the faithful to eat the meat of birds and their eggs during fasts significantly increased the frequency of chicken in the European diet. Asian jungle fowl were shaped for thousands of years before the Benedictine reform, but rapid changes in their genome 900 to 1200 years ago indicated the hallmarks of true domestication. At this time, the occurrence of a recessive form of the TSHR gene that is rare in jungle fowl increased dramatically in chickens. Today, this once rare form of the gene, which regulates growth, metabolism, and timing of reproduction, is the only type found in chickens. Possession of the recessive TSHR gene causes chickens to increase feeding efficiency and growth rate, lay eggs throughout the year, produce larger eggs, reduce their aggressive tendency, and lose their fear of humans. These traits enabled increased production of fowl, as well as the increased suitability of these fowl for urban husbandry. The evolutionary impact of agrarian life continues to change our genetic makeup. For example, reliance on cow's milk in northern climes is thought to have favored the evolution of genes that direct the production of lactase, an enzyme some of us produce that is essential for digesting milk. Similarly, an increasingly starchy diet has favored more genes that code for amylase, the enzyme needed to break those complex sugars into smaller bits that we can process. While tasty and nutritious, the sugars in our mouths were exploited by Streptococcus mutans, a bacterium that facilitates tooth decay by binding sugars to the tooth surface. We met this challenge with another evolutionary response, an increase in genes efficient at producing salivary agglutinin, which reduces the ability of Streptococcus to attack our teeth. Dogs, our earliest domestic associate on the farm, have also experienced changes in their genetic composition in response to our lifestyle. As our salivary enzymes matched an increasingly starchy diet, so too did similar proteins produced in the dog's pancreas. At the advent of agriculture, the genes coding for pancreatic amylase in farm dogs increased on average fivefold in number. This increase came well after the period of initial domestication, and has yet to affect dogs that were not domesticated by farmers. For example, dingoes and huskies do not have elevated amylase gene counts. Rapid evolution in the culture of farming, including changes in seeds, pesticides, herbicides, and fertilizers, has gifted the average farmer an ability to wring huge crops from the land. And as mechanization evolved to handle the excess, fewer hands were needed on the farm, thus providing a workforce able to revolutionize the industry, both on the farm and in the city. Before we too quickly revel in our agricultural accomplishments, we should note that many other animals also farm. For example, damselfish farm gardens of algae, and yeti crabs raise crops of bacteria. Gardening has also just been discovered in one of our distant relatives, the mouse lemur of Madagascar. A small primate appears to grow and tend fruiting plants, such as mistletoe. Lemurs enhance mistletoe growth by digesting seeds, which increase their germination. They also cut grooves in gum trees, which facilitate colonization by parasitic mistletoe. As their gardens grow, the lemurs seek shelter, especially for their weaned infants, under their dense, rigid branches. While intriguing, the accomplishments of these farmers are dwarfed by those of insects. Agriculture has evolved independently in three different orders of insects: ants, termites, and ambrosia beetles. These tiny farmers have perfected their craft over 50 million years of practice. Leafcutter ants are a familiar example. 40 species of leafcutter ants harvest pieces of wild plants and transport them to underground farms where they are used as compost to sustain crops of fungi that supply all the ants' dietary needs. Some 3,400 species of ambrosia beetles do likewise. They raise mushrooms for food and to stifle the defenses that trees employ against them. As the beetle larvae cut galleries within a tree, they feed on cultivated fungi and also use it to block resin and latex exuding from the damaged plant. Fungi farming insects weed their gardens to remove non-preferred fungi and use their own secretions and bacteria to control pests and diseases. Successfully farming a monoculture of mushrooms is not easy, but the insects accomplish the task by managing a consortium of microbes to fight infection. Not all insects farm fungi. Black garden ants ranch herds of aphids and harvest the sugary solution they exude. They use physical force and chemistry, biting off the aphids' wings and providing tranquilizers to slow the movements of their stock. Melissotarsus ants are also herders, but unlike the black garden variety, these ants imprison scale insects, known as diaspidids, in burrows under tree bark before eating them. Another ant species, Philodris nagasaw, from Fiji, has been farming for about 3 million years. These industrious workers gather seeds from 6 epiphytic plants, those that grow above ground, typically perched on tree branches in moist tropical forests. Ants gather and then wedge seeds from these plants into cracks in the bark of other trees where they germinate. Ants tend the developing seedlings by fertilizing them with their own waste. In return, as the crop grows, small cavities form in the plant's stems, which provide housing for the ants. These farmers are picky, preferring to harvest and plant only the epiphyte species that produce ant homes. It seems that other species of farmers have taken to their agrarian lives in much the same way as early humans. However, despite cultivating and tending a wide variety of crops and livestock, Non-human farmers have maintained a much more balanced relationship with those they have tamed. To my knowledge, humans remain the only species that create new varieties and species of plants and animals through selective breeding and hybridization programs. The rise of agriculture not only changed humans and those we tame, but also changed Earth. Our croplands and pastures now occupy more than a third of Earth's ice-free land, 37% as determined by the World Bank in 2015. Grazing, plowing, and clearing have simplified the abundant plant life that once carpeted the soil. Fields of a few principal grains and paddocks of pasture grass have replaced 70% of Earth's diverse grasslands, 50% of savannas, 45% of temperate forests, and 27% of tropical forests. Agriculture does not only affect dry land. Farmland irrigation accounts for 70% of humanity's use of fresh water. Productive wetlands are drained to increase arable land. The water that still flows through our farms carries inorganic fertilizers, nitrogen, and phosphorus, which are often applied too liberally to our crops, to our aquifers, as well as to marine and freshwater ecosystems. There, algae and other plants grow furiously and die, consuming the water's oxygen as they decay and creating dead zones, which wreak havoc on food webs, including many of our most productive fisheries. Although the changes to land and water are visible to the human eye, the invisible effects of agriculture on our atmosphere are equally profound. Real-time assays and analyses of ancient air trapped in the world's ice caps draw a tight link between agriculture and the release of greenhouse gases that drive climate change. Cropping, which reduced the ability of plants and soil microbes to absorb and store carbon, produced a noticeable rise in atmospheric carbon dioxide as early as 8,000 years ago. Methane also began to increase 5,000 years ago as domestic herds grew. Today, the belches of the nearly 4 billion ruminant animals, cows, sheep, goats, and buffalo, we herd, as well as the changes in land cover needed to feed them, are responsible for 18% of all human-caused greenhouse gas emissions. Those emissions drive climate change more than the exhaust from our planes, trains, and automobiles. Given the substantial effect of agriculture on our land, water, and air, it is no wonder that over 60% of species on Earth, assessed by the International Union for Conservation of Nature, are threatened with extinction by our agrarian life. As the way we worked the land changed, so too has the wildlife that inhabits farm and field. Farming is indeed a catalyst for change. Michael Shrub, a farmer and ornithologist, notes and illustrates this concept by considering how the progression of cultivation has sculpted the English land and in turn favored some birds over others. His story begins 6,000 years ago, when Neolithic farmers began clearing the forests. These early agrarians employed axe, fire, and brute strength to transform the woods into open grassland and heathland over time. Open country birds such as plovers, larks, and pipits certainly benefited from this change. In the mid to late 1700s, farmers typically grazed their hand-sown croplands after the harvest and then let the field lie fallow for a full year. Cropped fields were sparse, harvest was imperfect, and fallow lands were often plowed. These activities maintained open, weedy land, which together with residue from the harvest provided a bounty for quail, sparrows, and finches. The provision of fallow fields diminished during the 19th century as farmers raised fodder crops for livestock, thus allowing them to integrate crop and stock production. Farmers grew a diversity of cereal grains during this time, but rather than let the harvested field lie fallow, farmers replanted it with cover crops, such as clover, and root crops, such as beets, that were suitable winter fare for livestock. This high farming practice favored wood pigeons that fed on the tops of fodder beets and corn buntings that ate the waste cereal grain from the field and storage pile. The reliance on manure as fertilizer favored a vibrant soil invertebrate fauna, which benefited thrushes and plovers. Farmers began to manage their fields with a 3-year lay in the late 1800s, which continued for most of the next century. Fallow fields again increased, as fields cropped for 3 consecutive years were then laid fallow for 3 years. This alternation of crops and fallow grassy fields suited farmers who diversified their produce by tending small herds of dairy cows. World economics reduced the acreage farmed in the early 1900s, but this respite from the plow was short-lived as production geared up to feed a country at war from 1939 to 1945. Following the war, farmers increasingly relied on machines and chemicals to boost yields. Tractors quickly replaced horses. Dressings on seeds reduced loss to infection and pests. Bird life was quick to respond. Seed eaters, such as stock doves, chaffinches, and yellowhammers, were often poisoned by chemically treated seeds, and the plovers and thrushes that once feasted on worms and other soil invertebrates now found little food in the pest-free soil. The Green Revolution's hybrid seeds and increasing reliance on chemicals to protect and fertilize crops transformed farming throughout the latter half of the 20th century, with devastating consequences for biological diversity. Man-made nitrogenous fertilizers replaced manure and negated the need to graze or rest fields. This enabled farmers to specialize in a few crops, notably corn or wheat, rather than growing a diversity of plants selected for their ability to maintain soil fertility or provide food for the livestock, whose manure amended the soil. The increased use of herbicides, especially those that killed weed seeds before they could germinate, reduced the need to till the soil and eliminated many of the weeds whose flowers and seeds were essential to pollinators, doves, sparrows, buntings, partridge, and larks. The loss of native weeds, aka wildflowers, also reduced the availability of native insects and small rodents that drew warblers and raptors to the farm. The verdant fields, once so full of life, became eerily quiet. At some point, the pendulum had to swing back. In the beginning, the swing was slight, but now it is a movement, as indicated by an increase in organic or locally sourced produce in plain sight within nearly any grocery store. Since 1990, sales of organic foods have increased annually by about 20%. However, in their book Organic Futures, Connor Fitzmaurice and Brian Garreau are quick to point out that this is just the latest phase in a movement that began in the early 20th century in England. There, farmers believed their agricultural industry was overly reliant on man-made fertilizers, and as a result were willing to sacrifice soil health for crop productivity. The minority view that farms were living systems in need of understanding and nourishing rather than simply fertilizing spread to other parts of Europe and resonated especially in the United States during the American Dust Bowl of the 1930s. As organic growing techniques were improved through experimentation, the counterculture movement of the 60s and 70s gave ecologically friendly farming a second and distinctly anti-capitalist boost. Farmers' markets and food co-ops multiplied across the United States as activists sought ways to disrupt the chemically laden corporate industrial agricultural system. Still, organic products were kept out of the mainstream, in part by the political backing of agribusiness. United States Secretary of Agriculture Earl Butz, for example, pushed farmers to get big or get out and farm fence row to fence row. The success of organic agriculture that we see today arose primarily in response to the food scares of the 1980s and 1990s. Organic produce was seen as the perfect alternative to the industrial products that were tainted with carcinogenic pesticides and responsible for toxic and deadly outbreaks of botulism, Yersiniosis, Salmonella, and E. coli. The U.S. Organic Foods Production Act of 1990 brought organic foods into the American mainstream by recognizing and regulating their production. The organic food revolution continues to gain momentum. Sales of produce from certified organic farms in the United States increased 13% from 2014 to 2015, reaching a new record of $6.2 billion. There are now more than 12,000 certified organic farms that worked 4.4 million acres in 2015. That is a more than tripling of organic acreage since 1997. These farms grew crops on just over half of their land holdings and raised stock on the remainder, which was tended as pasture and range. Organic production in 2015 seems a lot until you realize that, across the United States in that same year, farmers and ranchers worked 912 million acres. In other words, only half of 1% of U.S. farmland is certified organic. Worldwide in 2016, a paltry 1% of humanity's farms are considered sensitive to the local and global ecology. The pendulum has moved, but it has a long way still to travel. Organic farming is not the only change that is pushing the pendulum. Some conventional and organic farms directly enhance wildlife habitat. These wildlife-friendly practices include not draining ponds or wetlands, intermixing elements of native surroundings, for example shade trees, among the crops to increase the ease with which migratory animals move through farms, planting winter cover crops that provide feed for waterfowl, fostering native plants along field edges that are used by pollinators and nesting birds, and grazing traditional grasslands that harbor species that specialize on short grass pastures, such as red-billed choughs in Scotland and Sharp's longclaw in Africa. Governments often incentivize such practices with direct payments to help farmers offset lost productivity. The European Union, for example, provided $2.7 billion per year from 2000 to 2006 to promote wildlife-friendly farming. The loss of productivity concerns some conservationists, who fear that if we share farms with wildlife, we will need more farms to feed humanity. Rather than share, they advocate coupling intensive farming with strategies to spare equal amounts of land from the plow. Sparing land in reserves may be the only way to save some shy or challenging animals that rarely survive close to humans. The argument to continue down the path of agricultural intensification hinges on the ability of future farmers to wring more food from each bit of land already in production, and a small amount more that will be added to the agricultural land base. This can be done to an unknown extent by relying on future technological enhancements in the careful application of fertilizers and pesticides, on the efficient use of freshwater, and on genetically engineering crops to produce higher yields. Indeed, these advancements, collectively known as precision agriculture, will be part of the solution. But if this path continues to rely on an ever-shrinking cadre of farmers who depend on large corporations serving the needs of shareholders rather than local residents, then increases in food production are likely to come at a high ecological cost, unless land sparing is linked forever with intensification. This linkage may be increasingly difficult, as the economic return possible if the reserved area is farmed rises with the possibilities afforded through precise agriculture. Advocates for both strategies, sparing or sharing land for wildlife, agree that the challenge to conserve Earth's biological diversity and feed an increasing human population will require changes in how we farm and what we eat. As the human population tops 9 billion by mid-century and 11 billion by 2100, farmers will be called on to double or triple their already impressive food production. Those favoring intensification suggest that humanity can be fed without destroying the planet if the advancements of the Green Revolution can be extended more fully to farmers in the developing world, and if new discoveries are made, such as how to breed perennial cereal crops, perpetuate high-yield hybrids through asexual reproduction, and supercharge plant photosynthesis. Others are convinced that a lighter touch will provide what we need. Perennial crops, for example, can produce more available energy for people than can annual cereal grains, according to Mark Shepard. This experienced polyculturist argues that a well-tended mix of fruits, nuts, berries, mushrooms, honey, and domestic livestock can produce over 5 million calories of human food per acre. Corn, which on today's industrial ag lands is mostly raised for biofuel and livestock feed, in contrast only produces 3 million calories per acre for people. An acre of Shepherd's polyculture could provide 8 people annual allotments of 2,000 calories per day. So, in an ideal world, just over 1 billion acres of polyculture could feed a population of 9 billion people while conserving land productivity and sustaining some biological diversity. The feasibility of agriculture, both intensive cereal cropping and ecological farming, to feed the world in 2050 was assessed in a much more holistic fashion by a team of social ecologists from Austria. Karl Heinz Erb and colleagues investigated the ability of 500 agricultural schemes to provide for the expected 2050 human population while also not encroaching on the world's forests. The schemes were all possible combinations of variation in crop yields, cropland expansion, livestock feeds, human diets, and the origin of livestock products. The research team determined that 60% of the schemes were able to supply the human population and maintain the Earth's existing natural and semi-natural lands. However, the viability of plans depended mostly on human diet. All options of farming were feasible if humans adopted a vegan diet, and nearly all, 94%, were possible if humans shifted to a vegetarian diet. Feeding the growing population.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.